the purity of faith. It happens to be chapter 112, surah number 112. Where do you find this? It'll tell you. If you want to find this at home when you have this Quran with you, you want to know about the unity of God. So many references among them, it'll tell you. Chapter 112. We will touch that this moment. If the book comes from God, it must speak about God. And the overwhelming theme of this book is God Almighty, the Creator. We are told to tell mankind, Kul, say, proclaim to mankind, Hu Allahu Ahad, that He is Allah, the one and only. Allahu Samad, God the Eternal Absolute. Lam yalid wa lam yulad, He does not beget and is not begotten. Wa lam yakun lahu kufuwan ahad, and there's nothing like it to Him. Four short verses completes this short chapter, Surah. And this chapter happens to be the acid test of theology. In the house of Islam, among the Muslims, whenever we offer prayers, we are told with Surah Fatiha, the first chapter of the Quran, if we read this short chapter three times, you get the barakah, the blessings of as if you have read the whole Quran. Just these four verses, three times, and the blessings of that is so great as if you have read the whole Quran. I don't know whether you're Malays, whether you have that type of information. This is what, is it? Is it true? No, it can happen. You see, I come from a country from South Africa, and originally I was born in India. Maybe the Indian Muslim know about this, and maybe, you know, somehow you have been deprived of that type of knowledge, I don't know. Therefore, I'm making it sure. Otherwise, the way this guy's pulling a fast on us. Now the question arises, how can you repeat just a short surah like that, of four verses, that all together 12 verses, only 12 sentences. You read and Almighty will give you that blessings as if you read the whole Quran. How is that possible? What is there in it? You see, this surah is the acid test of theology. There is not a concept of God that you can bring which either we accept or we reject with these four verses. There isn't. You can't think of any idea of God, whether it be a Hindu idea or a Christian idea or a Buddhist idea, any idea you bring, either these four verses, the acid test of religion. And this is how it came. This is how God Almighty sent it to the Prophet. It came as a need. The Holy Prophet Muhammad was in Medina. You remember? In Makkah, he suffered there at the hands of the mushriks, the pagans, the polytheists for 13 years. He was forced to flee for his life to Medina. There too they gave him no peace. But while in Medina, a Christian community in Najran, on the outskirts of Medina, they had heard that here is another Arab who is claiming to be in communion with God. He's claiming to be a prophet. And being knowledgeable people, people with their scripture, what the Quran calls them in the Holy Quran. Again and again, the Jews and the Christians are addressed as Ya Ahl al-Kitab, Ya Ahl al-Kitab, meaning, O people of the book, O people with the scripture, you are a learned people. Because of the learning about God and about revelation and about the prophets, they said, let's cross-examine this prophet among the Arabs. Let us see what he knows. So they came to Medina, and there were no hotels and no motels those days. And the people lived in little huts. So they had to be accommodated in the mosque of the Prophet. For 3 days and three nights, these Christians, Arab Christians, because they were Arab Christians, these Christians, they slept in the mosque, they ate in the mosque, and they had a dialogue for 3 days and three nights in the mosque, in the Masjid al-Nabawi, the mosque of the Prophet. And when Sunday came, it had to be coincidental that Sunday came in between. Our Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he offered his masjid to the Christians to offer the prayer. This is how tolerant he was. We today, I know some places, we are chasing the non-Muslim away. If you must, yes, you can peek through the window and see what's going on. Yes, our mosques are more holy than his. That's what the implication. The non-Muslims say, no, you can't come in. You can see from the outside. You treat them that way. What you're doing, you're actually chasing them away. You see, in my country, in South Africa, we are a little more advanced than the Arab countries, I'm telling you, and then the Malays. Our masjid there in Durban, the city of Durban where I come from, we are boasting that we have a masjid which is the largest in the southern hemisphere, south of the equator. And I'm happy that we are in the south of the equator, because north, you people would have, there's no comparison. Your masjids are so fantastic, so majestic, and so enormous in size that, you wouldn't have been able to boast. But fortunately, in the southern hemisphere, there are hardly any Muslim countries, very few, and among them, we can boast. And our masjid attracts a lot of visitors. The Durban Corporation, the municipality, brings 3 bus loads of tourists alone a week. Then church groups and school groups, they come along and visit the masjid. And passers-by, when they hear the azan, they're attracted, they want to know what the guy is crying about. No, the guy wants to know, what is this? He's wailing in the middle of the day through a loudspeaker. What is he saying? I tell you, it is so interesting, wallah, to explain to them. When you don't, they can make a mockery of it. So what is this? What's going on, man? What's going on in the middle of the day? But if you only explain, he says, you know what the guy is shouting about? What is he saying? He's saying, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Of course, he says it in a more sing-song way. You know why? So that the voice may travel. So Allahu Akbar, Allah. He's singing it along that the voice may travel. If he just shout, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, the voice is dying away. The secret of the azan is that the person, it might reach the longest distance 4 times. That Allah is the greatest, Allah is the greatest. And the person, if you explain to the inquisitive person, or a person who sincerely wanted to know, he said, look, the man is shouting that Allah is the greatest, Allah, 4 times. Then he continues, he says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, that I bear witness that there is no other object of worship but Allah. He continues, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. He said, I bear witness that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. He repeats it twice. If you accept these 2 fundamentals, that there is but one God, Allah, and Muhammad is his messenger. What is the message? The muazzin, the person who gives the ba'am, the azan. He continues. First he says, Allah is the only one that there is, he is the greatest, and Muhammad is his messenger. We are being warned 5 times a day, every day of the year, that don't make a mistake. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is only a messenger of God. He's a man, like any other human being. The difference is that Allah has inspired him. Whatever he says is from him. But otherwise, he's a man, flesh and blood, just like anybody else. Don't make a mistake. Like the others have done, they've made the prophets into gods, they've made the heroes into gods. Don't you do that. 5 times a day, the Muslim is warned that not to take Muhammad as a god. If you accept this fact, what is the message? It's Hayya ala salat, this has come to prayer. Hayya ala salat, explain. Hayya ala salat, this has come to prayer. Hayya ala falah, this has come to success. Because this is real success. That you remind yourselves about your duties and obligations towards your Creator and your duties and obligations towards your fellow human beings. If you want to be successful, there is no other way. Then he winds up the call by saying, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allah is still the greatest, Allah is still the greatest. Whether you come or you do not come, you are not going to lower him in his exaltation, in his majesty, in his glory, he still remains with you. And the final words of warning they give, the muazzin, the ba'am, in the ba'am, we call the people who give the ba'am, because I'm